seated. And it is my great pleasure on this first Sunday in spring to welcome our speaker this morning, practitioner Sandra Cooper, who is the vision of spring herself in this lovely spring color. She's a teacher, she's a leader, she's a practitioner par excellence. Please help me welcome Sandra Cooper.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. It truly is a pleasure for me to be here this morning, and it is an absolute delight to bring you the message this beautiful spring morning. I'm even more delighted that you made the choice to be here. And also you made the choice, those of you who are listening on the World Wide Web, to tune in to us. Now, baby's christening is always such a special experience. We've had about three this month, and every single time my heart opens. This morning we had twice the love and twice the blessing. These beautiful infants have an amazing journey ahead of them, don't you think? And they are starting their lives in a teaching that honors their greatness and beauty, their power and their perfection. Most of the rest of us might have taken a slightly different route and a little longer time to get here, coming from many other denominations. But here we are together this morning, having our thirst after righteousness being quenched by the waters of truth, and serving as witnesses to the blessing of these beautiful babies, to experience the beautiful ritual that we call a christening. I experienced a similar ritual in January this year, when the Jamaica Defense Force officially welcomed its new Chief of Defense Staff in a colorful change of command parade at the polo field at Up Park Camp. It was a magnificent display of pomp and pageantry, and I enjoyed every beautiful moment of it. Picture this: hundreds of troops dressed in the colors of their regiment, infantry, air wing, Coast Guard, flags flying high, marching in quick time, slow time, in perfect formation and choreographic precision, up and down the field. At one point, we even had aircraft flying overhead, and I let you into a secret. One of those pilots was our own Carol Charlton's son, Theo, a former Temple baby, now flying plane. But can you imagine the time, the effort, and the discipline that it must have taken to get everyone marching in time without missing a single beat? That's certainly how it appeared to me. Everyone going left, right in perfect time. There are some soldiers I know who said that at the beginning of their training, they didn't know their right foot from their left. There's even a joke about a drill sergeant who had noticed for the umpteenth time a recruit that kept going to his right on a left command. The instructor approached the directionally challenged Marine and stomped hard on his left foot, making the young man wince with pain. "Now," said the sergeant, "when I say left, it's the foot that hurts." But back to our parade. As I watched unfold in awe, it dawned on me that there was so much happening on the field that I thought was strikingly similar to this teaching we call the science of mind. So I'm going to spend some time this morning exploring some of these similarities in my message, which I've entitled Truth on Parade. The first thing that I found impressive at the parade was the perfect order on that field, demonstrated in the way the soldiers marched in formation. I read somewhere that troops who march in an irregular and disorderly manner are always in great danger of being defeated in battle. So they work at perfecting the march, maintaining order in their steps, and being perfect, being in perfect formation and never cutting corners. You ever notice that they, even when they're turning around, they go all the way up to one point and then turn. And it just is absolutely amazing. And by the way, you ever notice that sometimes they will march with eyes right? Sorry, that's left. Or they will march with eyes right. Okay? And I always wonder how come they don't get mixed up. I mean, they still maintain that perfect formation. Well, I learned that they have a soldier called a marker that stands in front with his eyes straight ahead. And somehow they're able to maintain the formation moving forward with that one soldier in front with everybody else's eyes, left or right. The practice of truth also requires us to live from a sense of order, harmony, and focus. Even when we sometimes look away and move away from the path, there is a part of us, our divine presence, that acts as our spiritual marker, urging us back on track, enabling us to maintain the focus. The soldiers made each turn in perfect formation without cutting corners. It's a practice that can augur well for us as we walk our spiritual path. Cutting corners disrupts our spiritual practice. We can't skip our prayer work and expect to stay on track. If we do, we run the risk of being seduced by circumstances, by what's happening in the world of effect, by the news headlines, people's opinion, etc., etc. Marching in formation also made me think about the idea of vibration with our greatest good. Let's look at this idea a little closer. The various mental, physical, emotional, and spiritual states that we experience are simply different levels of vibrating energy and frequency. Thoughts and feelings of fear, hatred, envy, anger, grief, and despair vibrate at a slow and low frequency, setting us up to attract negative, life-draining experiences. On the other hand, thoughts of love, happiness, joy, and gratitude vibrate faster and higher, enabling us to attract more positive, life-giving experiences. One's vibrational frequency, therefore, has a direct impact on our experience of reality. It is the magnet that attracts our life's experiences, and that's why we need to exercise great care for how we choose to exist on this earth, and it always is about choice. What we choose to experience and how we choose to evolve and grow our lives. The next thing that struck me as I watched the parade was a subtle presence of military power on the field. With its training, weaponry, and intelligence network, armies like the Jamaica Defense Force have the potential to wield great power. Yet for the most part, the JDF serves as a peacekeeping entity. As divine sons and daughters of God, each of us is also gifted with extraordinary power. According to Dr. Ernest Holmes, the founder of this great teaching we call the Science of Mind, and I quote, "We have within us a power that is greater than anything, a power that can overcome every obstacle in our experience and set us safe, satisfied, and at peace, healed and prosper us in a new light and a new life." End of that quote. The power which Dr. Holmes talks about is the infinite intelligence of God, the omnipresent spirit that created, maintains, and sustains each and every one of us. We channel the power of spirit when we are in our creative element, when we are living our divine purpose, when we sing and dance and make music and develop new technology and write proposals and solve problems. This power is our authentic power, the fuel behind an inexhaustible wellspring of indwelling creativity that produces answers to problems, creates magnificent dance works and operas, architectural masterpieces, technological innovations, works of art, and soul-stirring writings. Indeed, there is a power for good in the universe, and we can use it. The same way we have access to electric power just by flicking on a switch, we can access the power source at the center of our being, our authentic power. So how do we develop this authentic power? We have to begin and end each day with God. It can't be any other way. Making a commitment to actively live from principle. We need to learn to use this power by coming to class, to deepen our understanding of spiritual truths, and knowing that these truths will support us in how we live from our authentic power. We need to put God first and at the center of every single choice we make. So God, what I must do now? Where do I go? What direction should I take? How do I resolve this issue? I can guarantee that the answer will come. The next thing is to practice forgiveness. An authentically empowered person is one who forgives, who releases critical judgment, and does not cling to regret or negativity. To know that without any doubt at all, in God, all things are possible. To be still and court the Spirit's creative presence. When all is quiet, invite the infinite wisdom of God to create through you. Let your mind receive images and ideas of what's possible and to guide you in the direction of their manifestation. In other words, we know what we want in our hearts. When we ask the divine, the direction comes to us and through us. And so we need to trust that this answer will come to us, fueled by our authentic power, and that it will be made real in our experience. And last, by no means least, let's affirm that there is always a solution to any challenge that we might have. Isaiah 45 verse 2 tells us, I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. So whatever the situation, the diagnosis or the prognosis, know that there is a higher unlimited power working in, around and through us now. Believe in this power and then act with confidence, certain of the favorable outcome. Perhaps the most important lesson coming out of that military parade was a sense of the amazing discipline that it must take for troops to ready themselves for public display, to appear in such perfect formation. In the military, discipline is that set of rules that is ingrained in soldiers through their training and ensures compliance to orders to create a cohesive military unit. Spiritual discipline, on the other hand, is the means by which we seek to know God, yield to the power of spirit within us, and surrender to the divine will. For the soldier, the discipline of the drill enables him to gather information and information, and react to words of command from their leaders. For us as truth students, prayer or meditation puts us in a state of peace and oneness with spirit. It's a time when we nurture and feed our soul and bond with our creative, loving source energy. It could be safe to say that as we practice disciplined thinking through the good soldiers of choice and will, we're able to keep the peace in our own minds, choosing to rise above turbulent thoughts and the opinions of others. And now, friends, it is my special privilege to invite one of our temple family, a member of my family, my son, who is here visiting from overseas, at least that is how he makes it sound, to just share a couple words with you about his experience of discipline. Please help me welcome Kevin.
Buenos morning. Great looking crowd. I was told to just share my experience as far as incorporating discipline, determination, and dedication to battling this overwhelming challenge that is no longer being able to see, which ironically has led me to be able to see that I am the be-all and end-all of my circumstances and my surroundings and the impact I have on the people that are in those surroundings. And I have to make a decision every single, I'd say, moment of my existence to say, okay, I choose positivity, I choose inspiration, I choose to get up when I don't feel like getting up. And the choices that are the right choices are never, ever the easy choices. There is no shortcut to a destination worth going to. So any choice that comes effortless to me, I have to actually question it, because it would simply mean that it is a choice coming from a place of self-centeredness as opposed to being empathetic towards others. And after all, I'm not just me, we're all collectively giant, and we should be accountable for everybody else. And to lead by example and not be down in a world that gives us so many reasons to be down takes a lot. You know, and my main tool is self-awareness. It's almost like I divide myself into two people and I climb out of my body and I observe myself, and I will cuss the living crap out of myself if need be, when I know that I am behaving against my authenticity or I'm behaving in a way that's going to affect somebody negatively as opposed to make them walk away feeling inspired. You know, it's not easy, but anything that I have done and accomplished that hasn't been easy has been so, so worth it. And that's why I keep going. And when I don't feel like doing it, that's when I know it's important. Because I know of the importance of being a vessel, of being a tool, of being an example, of being dedicated to making a change by implementing various actions. It just doesn't happen overnight, and at the end of the day, I'm human. And I have my days, but the rest of the world doesn't need to know that. The rest of the world needs to see somebody who has not let the circumstances get to them, somebody who has decided that this is going to be the chariot that races me towards the bright future that is ahead of me. But I couldn't do it without these tools. And the discipline, the dedication, the determination has been, you know, my saving grace, and I'm grounded because of it, I'm grateful because of it, and I'm thankful, and I owe a lot to it. So that's just my peace of mind now.
Thank you, Kevin. I have learned a lot from this young man, because there are times when I feel to give up, and he's my inspiration. So the expression of order and discipline, pageantry and military prowess demonstrated by our Jamaica Defense Force on that balmy, hot January afternoon was not an act of chance. It was deliberate, the result of months and months of disciplined drill and practice. The master teacher Jesus demonstrated a discipline and power that enabled him to turn water into wine, heal the sick, raise people from the dead, and bring himself back to life following his crucifixion. Jesus could not have arrived at that level of spiritual power without a disciplined spiritual practice. We saw him going off to pray many times, and we believe that he spent time during the undocumented early years of his life growing in consciousness and deepening his relationship with his spiritual father. Jesus' spiritual prowess was therefore not a chance thing. A successful military parade is not a chance thing. The ability to rise above circumstances and enjoy the freedom of the life more abundant that we have been promised is not a chance thing. So I challenge you to be deliberate about your spiritual practice, to keep eyes front in spite of what might be going on around you. And make this choice this week to do just one thing to deepen your relationship with God. Begin and end your day with prayer, if only for 15 minutes. It will make an amazing difference to your life. And as we close, I just invite you now to say these affirmations with me. Spirit's eternal command keeps me in perfect harmony with my highest good. Together. Spirit's eternal command keeps me in perfect harmony with my highest good. The indwelling power of the Christ keeps me safe, poised, and at peace. The indwelling power of the Christ keeps me safe, poised, and at peace. And the last one, I pray without ceasing, surrendering fully to the nurturing guidance and wisdom of Spirit. I pray without ceasing, surrendering fully to the nurturing guidance and wisdom of Spirit. Friends, I read somewhere that a good soldier is faithful. He or she endures the rigors of training and does not quit. They can face whatever life throws at them with patience, perseverance, and the determination to soar. I invite you to consider being a faithful soldier of truth, powerful and passionate in your striving to live the truth. The reward, only you can determine that. Namaste.